Pay me an equity, pay me an equity, pay me an equity. Hey, you can spot to me. Pay me an equity, pay me an equity, pay me an equity. Hey, you could pay that fee. 2019, give them a shutdown. Gotta grind these bands up now. Who may need that rent? Hockey need tuition. I'ma make sure the network will go missing. 2019, give them a shutdown. Gotta grind these bands up now. Who may need that rent? Hockey need tuition. I'ma make sure that not one meal go missing. BBB blippin' is bond, let's do some business. Take a oath to stand and test the time amongst a witness. Oh, I see you unite with me and see what dice see. A time and place where we regain society. We live in peace, no longer amongst poverty. Freedom, peace, love, truth, and equality.
Don't wanna get blackballed, assassinated, I won't say much. Just call that card and call what you say for.
Election time, I'm shaking hands and politicking. Pulling strings, I won't explain, it's not your business. Flawless flaw, I do my thing, respecting my name. I'm very professional, living my tribe, don't play. Pay me an equity, pay me an equity, pay me an equity. Hey, you can spot to me. Pay me an equity, pay me an equity, pay me an equity. Hey, you can pay that fee. On the road to riches, private location switching. Stacking this paper, I'm getting this dope. Loving the beat when I'm switching the flow. My word of God, and I'm blessing you all. Dropping seeds of knowledge, worth millions if you apply it. Moving silence with the MMT, put upon longevity. 2019, moving steadily, progress with the family. Did a challenge, solidarity, and animals we ride. Reshift the paradigm, currency multiply. Devout the troll. Hit me an equity, hit me an equity, hit me an equity. Hey, you can spot to me. Hit me an equity, hit me an equity. Pay me an equity, but you could pay that fee.
Look, my bitch is all bad, my niggas all real. I ride in his dick, it's a big tall hills. Big fat checks, big large bills. Run out, flip like 10 car wheels. Cold ass bitch, I get frost chills. 10 different looks and my lips all kill. I kiss him in the mouth, I feel all grills. Heat in the car, that's wheels on wheels. Woo! I was born to flex, diamonds on my neck. I like boarding jets, I like morning sex. But nothing in this world, I like more than checks.
Yeah, though. Welcome to NR International. CC, turn me up in those headphones, turn me up in the mic. This is Mr. Make It Rain, Nor Rainy, and
Flawless Flaw, Peace, Love.
The first thing that we had that money talk by yours truly.
Shit. Yeah.
Just, you're welcome. And we followed up with that money by Cardi B.
Mm-hmm.
That drink was hot. Talk to him about it, like... You know what I'm saying? Like, you just came out of there from out the blue. Just like, all right, I'm going to just start this talking this money talk or what? How did that go down?
So, shout out Lee Beats. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely shout out Lee Beats.
Slide me the song. So He blessed me, so I blessed y'all. It was only right. It was only right.
True that.
Fuck Trump. Let me start off by saying, first and foremost.
First and foremost. Get out the way.
2019 government shutdown. Like, shit is real. And we definitely been making sure that the platform that we have, we bring attention and awareness to things that are affecting us in our community.
Absolutely.
And so, in my music, I always give you guys what you want, but I always try to elevate and maybe use a little bit of lingo that you may not know. I'm definitely very professional, as you can tell, and as you can see. I'm the CEO of Flawless Flaw Entertainment, so I believe that it is balance between being who you are personally and then the professional. And I understand that Philly suffers a lot because we have a bad image.
And right. We do.
As far as our professionalism goes.
Full of ratchetness.
You said it, not me.
Yeah.
But,
no, we're going to keep it real. We're going to keep it real on this. On this. Like, at the end of the day, most people know that if you look at most ratchetness on the internet, you look at most situations that come from out of Philly, normally, I mean, if it's on the internet, normally it comes out of Philly. And then it spreads from there. It's like a plague.
Mm.
Damn it.
I mean, I ain't proud of it. But however, it's not about where you come from. It isn't. It's about where you're going. So, keep that in mind.
Always. Awesome.
Can we get to some DK?
Well, first, let's we got to introduce. We got a host to the house.
Yes.
We got a guest to the house. And you know, we have to always deal with our guests with them, but in the most hospitable ways. I would like to welcome Miss Shakita Ellison, Gift of the Pen, y'all.
Hey.
How are you feeling today?
One of my favorite poets.
I feel wonderful. I'm glad I'm alive.
Absolutely.
I'm glad I have my right mind. So
look very blessed. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Hey, we gotta be thankful for every day that goes by, for the fact that our heart beating, for the fact that, you know, we have body parts that work correctly, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's like the saying goes, we gotta always think about what people are less fortunate not to have and recognize what we do have, and that's what makes us more grateful every day that goes by.
Yes, right. You look to those less fortunate than mm-hmm. yourself, and you can find, you know, gratitude there.
Absolutely. So, let's go to that DK news. Did you know?
DK? So, talking about money and Cardi.
Money.
Yeah, a 10-year-old Kayla, mm-hmm. a.k.a. Kiki, made a remix. Well, she let them Girl Scout cookies, okay? She made a remix to Cardi Money. And within, what, not even a week, she posted this video, and it went viral after Cardi reposted it, and she posted it February 2nd. So,
hey, so
shout out to young,
yes,
black, yes, entrepreneurs.
Yes,
yeah.
And
it's never too early.
And we also got to say salute to Cardi, because that's utilizing your fan base and your, yep, platform to help other people. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
Some of y'all selfish.
A lot of y'all selfish.
But you know, we ain't worried about
those. So what exactly did she do? She just remade the song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Put her own little twist to it.
Yeah, but she was selling Girl Scout cookies. So based off of that, it's like, you know, she was hustling, made a little rap to it, mm-hmm. right?
She shouted out Black Girl Magic.
Uh-huh.
And definitely went viral. She sold a lot of Girl Scout cookies. So yeah. Big ups, Kayla.
Hey, I think she needs some she needs to get some type of some stock into Girl Scout cookies now. If,
yeah, she needs some stock. She needs some equity. You know what I'm saying? Let her get some equity.
Because you ain't going to just have my little sisters out here like to need some workers. You know what I'm saying?
No.
No. She needs stock in the company now.
For sure.
So, now, what we're going to, I think that today's topic should be, since we're talking about young money, I think we need to talk about, like, why is it that our communities are in the situations that they're in? Like, why is it that, I mean, for the most part, most of our communities are either striving to get by or barely there, but, you know, it's like our youth. A lot of people aren't thinking of being owners. A lot of people aren't thinking about being entrepreneurs. And if they are, then they're thinking about it in the wrong ways. So I think we should dedicate today's topic on raising our youth right.
Mm-hmm.
Rearing them, cultivating them right, making sure that they grow up to be everything that they're supposed to be and not what they've been trained to be.
Drop the mic on that and repeat that one more time.
Shout out to Miss Lady C on the
train.
But I think that we really need to dedicate today's topic on the fact that there's a lot of social engineering going on, and that social engineering is going on by way of what we hear, what we see every day.
And it starts off at a very, very pre-K age,
mm-hmm.
young age. When we are getting these, our beloved children indoctrinated mm-hmm. to the system.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of times, most people don't even recognize when they themselves are indoctrinated. And mm-hmm. so therefore, they don't know what they're passing down. You know? It's kind of like, what was that name of that movie with Denzel Washington back in the day? It was The Fisher Story, where he was getting abused because his mother was getting abused. And our people have been getting abused for a very long time, and that's when it comes down to mentally, emotionally, sp- spiritually and physically.
Hurt people, hurt people.
Hurt exactly. people, hurt people. Yeah. Exactly. And it's like, it doesn't, and I said this before, it doesn't matter if you have someone who loves you. If they don't know, they don't know. Like, I used to always talk to different people who would just come home from, say, for instance, for prisons, and they have a disdain for people who would, like, for instance, give them work when they come home, pull some, giving them money, put them in positions of street life, or pull some, putting them in positions of building by themselves. And I had to sit them, to pull them to the side and say, well, you understand, though, that I might be the only way that they understood how to help out, even though, like, we may look at it from a point of view of, if you're just coming home, you just did 10 years or 15 years or whatever, and somebody's just pretty much letting you toss rocks at the penitentiary, letting you say, all right, well, you know, do what you gotta do, you know what I'm saying? That might lead you right back. But in a certain type of way, they don't know. Mm-hmm. You know? So it's like, we gotta get ourselves out of this social engineering where we don't recognize, we're not aware. Because what happens is that's what puts our people into the same mix, the same rotation, especially of recidivism, right? So, you know, just my thought when it comes down to it. So when we look at it from the scope of adults, we can just imagine what's going on with kids, you know? Mm-hmm. So what you think on it?
Children emulate what they see. Mm-hmm. You know, in psychology, it's a term called learned conditioning. You know, so, you know, our children, they're being exposed to so much. I mean, what they're seeing in the homes, from alcoholism to, you know, parent neglect, mm-hmm. to one parent families, or, you know, an absentee parent. And then you have children who we have mixed families. So therefore, you know, you have one set of children who may be going out the home every weekend or every other weekend, and then they're being exposed to certain things that you don't have any knowledge of. So when we look at things like, you know, children molesting children, you know, this isn't anything that mm-hmm. they just thought up on their own. Children are innocent, you know. Mm-hmm. So they had to have been exposed to it and had to have seen it in some type of way, form, and fashion. And unfortunately, most times than not, you know, they've been a victim of it. So, you know, it's just about awareness, you know, and just having to educate our children. And also being careful about what we expose them to. The television shows, I mean, you know, us being in a socially driven era, most of these children have phones. I mean, they have iPhones as young as, like, maybe 5 and 6 years old.
Right, and know how to use it.
Right, and like, even the babies, they know how to swipe up and go this way, and you be looking like, wow.
And it's like, it takes certain adults to... Mm-hmm. years to get used to it,
which means that they're exposed to your photos, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. and it may be something in there that they shouldn't be exposed to. Mm-hmm. Also, too, you know, what they're watching on TV and the music. Mm-hmm. The music, to me, in this era, is to dumb us down, because definitely. You can't hear. You can't really understand what anyone's saying.
There's no substance.
You hear the beat, and you get the chorus, mm-hmm. and it's catchy, and it stays with you all day long. But really, what's the content? Mm-hmm. Where's the wisdom? Where's the motivation? There isn't any, you know. And so I think that in the industry, being a multi-billionaire industry, I think that they know exactly what they're doing when they take. What, Little Pump or
mm-hmm. Autumn Lowe? Autumn Lowe.
Every little.
6ix9ine, 9'6". Yeah, every little nerd out. All of
Black. Whoever. And it's like, you know, they have no talent, but they throw the chains on them. Mm-hmm. They give them the cars. They give them the homes. They say, oh, we can move you out the hood. And, you know,
just
that's,
for misleading. Mm-hmm.
But see, that's the first part of training. That's the first part of social engineering, where it's like you getting the kids dumbed down to the point where everything shiny is gold. Mm-hmm. So what happens is that now they're looking at the materialism. They're looking at everything which is just allure, all of the allure of what's being seen.
Instant gratification.
Of
millennials are
the jewelry, the girls, the cash. And this is the reason why, like I say this all the time when it comes down to social media, I'm like, if you got all these guys with cash phones, it's like the only ones that actually care about stacks like that is either one, you going to the strip club. Two, you must have just got that off of the block, because anybody else is getting money, it's swiped. Everything is swiped. So this is a digital era. Like, this isn't the 90s anymore.
Where
so,
cash rules everything around me. Green. The money.
Dollar bills, y'all.
Then we all just tell our age.
No, but I mean, the thing about that, that's a classic, though. So, you know, even millennials know that, even if they don't know who said it.
Right.
You know? Sure. So it's like, just look at that point that I just said by itself, where you got people who... they dumbed you down. They're showing you all of the materialism. And then, like, just the basic part of having racks on racks put to your ear, just showing money. Meanwhile, we're not even in that era anymore where people are just showing money because you can just swipe it. Like, instead of showing cash, let's see how many homes you own. Let's see how much, you know, how many properties you have. Let's see appreciative value of, you know, just items. Let's see if you own a Basquiat. Let's see if you own you know, something which is going to appreciate in value opposed from depreciate. Jewelry, all that other guns and butter. Y'all heard Baby Boy, right? It's about guns and butter. So if we didn't know, if you didn't learn that part off of the movie, I don't know what we learned.
Right.
That was
right.
One of my favorite parts.
I bet.
So, but it's like we have a lot of different things that our children are being subjected to. And it's like, if we don't catch it, and we grown adults, right? If you reach to, even if you reach the age of 16 years old, I still consider you as a grown adult. Because personally, I realized that, you know, most of us are having families starting at 16. Most of us are leaving out the house around 16, whether it's legal or not. So.
I think one of the biggest questions is that, you know, how do we get our children back? How do we go in and literally grab them by the collar and say, okay, I know what you're seeing, mm-hmm. I know what you're hearing, but this is falsehood. You know what I mean? This is, you know, we need to sit down and come up with a stratagem on how you can become a successful adult in society and not think that instant gratification or the crab in the barrel mentality is how you should live your life. Mm-hmm. You know, so I think that that's what we need to sit down at a round table and try to figure out. How do we get our children big? Because they're stationary. Everybody's on their phones. You know what I mean? Everybody's on Instagram, you know, trying to sell themselves, you know, and
right, feel, love,
exactly. So how
value.
Do we right? How do we? And then if you're in a home where you're not being nurtured, then you're looking outward to social media, to your friends, for guidance, because no one's guiding you. So how do we recognize those children, and what do we do to get our children back so that we can have another generation? Because at this rate where our children are being slain, you know, like every other week there's another child being slain, you know, down Park Avenue, 14 years old, you know, a couple weeks ago, 18 years old. You know what I mean? So what do we want to do? Because the time is now.
I would say the very first thing is that we can't forget our own childhoods. That's the first thing, how you reach into, you know, to the minds of the youth. Some people say, oh, well, it's not, they're not the same. They didn't come up at the same time that we came up. But the reality is, even if certain things are different, a child's mind is still a child's mind. So if a person loses how they were when they were a child, then they can't reach the children. But if you remember the things that caused you to look at certain things, or to, you know, to gravitate towards certain things, you have to also know, if it was negative, how to combat that.
Right.
So I see it as though the very first way that we lose our children is the fact that we aren't strong enough. Majority of people aren't strong enough. They don't show, as men, they don't show manhood within the houses. Or they're pretty much stuck in a rut. So it's like, let's just say for those who end up looking at most of these rappers, what's the thing that causes for most of these kids to look at the rappers? The fact that they got money, cars, clothes, girls, etc. So, all right, so what that's saying is that if you're looking at them, how are you looking at your own father? And unfortunately, a lot of times, a father is probably locked up for trying to chase that same dream.
That's the first way to break down the infrastructure of the family is to remove the black man.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And so we have all of these men incarcerated, and women are left to raise the children by themselves. And, you know, although most black women are very strong, they don't have that innate ability to raise a man. Absolutely. And it's been great men, you know, who were raised by single women. Don't get me wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So it can be done. However, you know, it more times than none, there is that single mom,
mm-hmm,
who's working two or three jobs just to keep the food on the table, just to, you know, be able to provide school clothes and so on and so forth. So the children are left alone a lot of times. And that just piggybacks over what we were saying earlier. Mm-hmm. So they're left idle, mm-hmm, you know. And, I mean, look how many libraries have been shut down. I mean, sure. You said thinking about our childhood, we hung out at the library.
Yeah,
remember, you know, if you went to the library and you made too much noise, you got kicked out, mm-hmm, because you was not going to be in the library goofing off.
Mm-hmm.
So I think a lot of the education, I think that now education is being, the education of our children has been left to the school system. And we already know,
mm-hmm,
that the school system isn't the best education. Why? Because they want to tell us that we were monkeys. Through evolution.
Yeah,
and that's not correct. You know what I mean?
And that's another part, though, about us not being educated enough. I mean, again, it got to go back to, we can only give what we got.
Exactly.
So if we don't have it, then it causes for our own children to look more towards those who do.
Well, I think it's just a matter of being honest.
Mm-hmm.
Because if my mom didn't show me the ropes, or if I'm a young adult and I'm having my first child at 14 or 15 years old, and then, you know, now, you know, 10 years later I'm dealing with this, you know, 10 year old,
mm-hmm,
what do I do? First of all, you have to be honest, and the first part of any solution is recognizing that there's a problem.
Mm-hmm. Agree. And if you are wrong, I know that parents have a hard time admitting when they have shortcomings,
mm-hmm,
when they failed, when, you know, mm-hmm, they've done the best that they could, so in their head, oh, this is, you know, I did my best, so it's fine, it's right. It's not all right, because whether I hurt you on purpose or on accident, you're still hurt.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, parenting classes, just being aware, you know, more social workers go into the home, or more social workers inside the school system to actually assess what's going on in the homes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if we need to come up, like, with a little survey question sheet or, you know, something, but being more involved in trying to figure out what are these children being exposed to and how do we help them.
You had asked the question, how do we reach them?
Mm-hmm.
And understanding that, you know, they're hurt. When kids act out, they're hurt. If you, mm-hmm, don't understand them, it's because somewhere down the line there's a disconnect.
Mm-hmm.
Now, whether that be they are in denial and in trying to numb the pain or forget, we have to reach them. We have to connect with them.
Mm-hmm.
We, like you said, we were children once too. We should understand.
So we have to understand.
Exactly. And not by always trying to be superior, but coming to an eye level with them and saying, listen, I understand. You're not alone. Okay, well, in addition to molding them and understanding and healing, because I believe that a lot of healing has to happen.
Absolutely.
So much damage has happened.
Mm-hmm.
It's time for us to unite and heal one another.
But when it's at the level of the parents, what do you do at the level of the parents?
At the level of the parents, you gotta love them. And even that love gotta go even to the point of
not being their friend, but making sure that that position of parent is solidified. And then you can go back to, you know, the basic relationship of one-on-one father-daughter, father-son, or son-mother-daughter, mother relationships, where you do have that companionship, but at the same time, you have to make sure that that's solidified first. It got to start out of love, because there's some people who say, well, I will not, you know, do anything to my child as far as, like, you know, I'm not going to beat them, or I'm not going to do, but, I mean, sometimes you do have to do some type of punishment at times to get them right, you know? But if you're going to do that, they still have to understand that you're doing this because you love them. And if you don't understand that love, then, I mean, it's like you're going to just leave them to the wolves. You're going to let them drop to the system. You're going to let them fall. As some polls say, if you're going to beat your child, do so before these police get a chance to.
Mm-hmm. And like you said, love, yeah. Love is all we need. Mm-hmm. I was referencing at the dysfunction being at the level of the parents. Mm-hmm. So if the parents are the perpetrators, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. What do we do then? Because the parents are not going to say, oh, there's a problem, when you're the one being dysfunctional. You're, you know, high. You got men running in and out, you know, and so on and so forth. So what do we do at that level? That's why I mentioned having more social workers assessing in the schools what's going on and paying attention to the signs and symptoms of, you know, our children being abused.
Well, the abuse level is something completely different. First, we gotta look at each particular child as an individual, and then once we end up recognize that individual in regards to all the things that they need as individuals, then we can rise from there. But before we continue on the conversation, let's play that "Love" by Tory Lanez. Welcome back to NR International. You now rocking with Philly's Finesse, Mr. Make It Rain, Noah Rainey, and
Flawless Flaw, Peace Love.
We were just talking on how to raise our youth right, because unfortunately we live in a city where our kids is running reckless, and that's just the reality of it. Like, we have so many different issues within the city of Philadelphia. Especially the fact that you have so many kids that's adopted, foster care, mm-hmm. some Perfect. Just living out of bandos, and I mean, really, a lot of kids just need love. So I feel as though we gotta, especially as the men, we have to be able to do as many of the people of the past used to. Which is, you gotta take people, the youngins, underneath your wing. Because some of them don't have fathers. Some of their fathers are in the penitentiaries for life. Mm. And if they're not there for life, then they're there for, say, the majority of their childhood. So we gotta take it upon ourselves, if we're there, to be an example. And that's what goes back to what I was saying about being strong men, showing strong values, being strong examples for others to see. Right? As women, I would say it's the same thing. Whereas many of us are raising daughters. So that means that it has to be a strong female presence more than what people are seeing. And that means that we gotta sometimes shake that youthful mentality and be able to show that womanhood. So that the girls can grow up to be women. At a certain age, we gotta say, all right, well, it's not cool right now to twerk unless you wanna be in a certain place to twerk. Let's not do this everywhere, though.
Everybody twerk.
But just learning how to conduct yourself, like, period.
Right.
I believe that women are the first nurturers, the first examples of teachers and of love.
Mm-hmm.
And so by that, that comes a big responsibility.
In
despite frustration, despite, you know, selfishness.
In Arabic, you have the word Umm. The word Umm means mother. You can't have a nation, which means Ummah, without the mother. It's the mother that raises the nation.
Mm-hmm.
So.
But these women don't know how to be mothers. They don't know how to be girls because, listen, this is me personally. And I'm not taking a shot at anybody. And
shout out to Buck, you know what I'm saying, for coming.
And I'd like to introduce yes. Buck Wild, comedian Buck Wild. Buck Wild 215. Make sure y'all follow him. Step into
thank
the building.
You. Welcome. Me. Thank you. No, I was listening and I was being, you know, I wanted to be selective and very careful with what I put out in the universe because I just told them, I just gave them some good news that I'm about to be a grandfather. My daughter's 26. She's pregnant. And I was trying to tell her, listen, man, you got to step up. Like, when you do this, when you had this child, it's you. Mm-hmm. You know, it's nobody else. It's you. You got to be a mother. You got to be a good neighbor. You got to be a good role model. You got to exemplify in your definition of your character and raise your child right. Because a lot of times I meet a lot of women, man, and they was molested at a young age. Like that R. Kelly stuff,
mm-hmm.
That's a very touchy.
Absolutely.
Touchy. Like I damn near got booed last week because I was like, the difference between Richard, I said Bill Cosby ain't got shit on R. Kelly.
Mm-hmm.
From the outside looking in,
mm-hmm.
Like what he was alleged of doing and what he was found guilty of doing,
right.
The pills and R. Kelly actually manipulating people with
minors
and doing paperwork at 14.
Yeah.
Then I had a Christian boy say, "Well, damn, the Prophet Muhammad saw his album. He married what you call him at the age of boom 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 boom." I'm like, "But that's a different time. That's over 1400 years ago." He's like, "But."
And I think in the first year,
it was socially accepted.
Yeah, but it wasn't socially accepted. My grandma was married at 13. Her first baby was at 14.
Mm-hmm.
But that was that time. But the parents knew. But we talk about a situation where the parents didn't know.
Exactly.
You see what I'm saying? And then how many of them had Aaliyah?
Yeah.
Aaliyah went through Dame Hove. No, Nas. No, like me. It's like...
We definitely respect
you better.
That,
yeah, you really got to do your homework on that. And then what about Jay-Z? Like, he was dating Beyonce or certain stuff. That's why Jay-Z ain't get on the documentary and talk about certain stuff.
She was 16 when she first came out. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, y'all look at that.
She,
like,
what? I mean, she was 16.
She was just turning 18.
They were saying all that. She probably was 14. No, you really don't know.
Absolutely.
Well, white, God knows best.
Yeah.
But I say all that to say that a lot of women out here right now, like, I opened the door for some chick. This coming in, and this was funny. And I was like, here you go. She's like, no, I got it. I'm like, damn, Shivery ain't there with me.
Right.
Like, where's it? It's so fucked up out here that you can't even open a door for a woman or give her a compliment without her being offended.
Nasty.
You see what I'm saying? Because this Me Too movement is going too fucking far.
Mm-hmm.
And this gay shit is going too far. Whereas
way
though you can't
too
have
far.
The freedom of speech is number your First Amendment. But they celebrate the fifth more than the first. The right to bear arms.
That's the second.
But I'm about to say the fifth is what people need to plead and stop snitching.
Yeah, stop snitching. Yeah, but I'd say the W.O. has been taking off the woman name. So they just running around like they men.
Well, mm-hmm. I think the problem is that.
And they don't know how to put the damn W.O. back on.
Women are forced to. Women are forced to, am I still alive? Is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
We still
women, women are forced to play a dual role because our men are either incarcerated, as we mentioned earlier,
gay.
Or they're dead or
gay.
Mm-hmm.
So when you put a woman in a position where, you know, she's the head of the household, it's a whole different dynamic. The psyche of everybody in the household is going to change. You know what I mean? Because mom is, you know, she's out of the house most of the time and she's making all the decisions and a lot of her decisions are, you know, emotionally based. You know what I mean? So it's different factors that we have to look at. And then also too, women are tired. what Tupac say? It's time to heal our women, be real to our women.
Real to our women.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, a lot of women are just really hurting. And again, hurt people. So they're mm-hmm. having these children and they're hurting. And they don't know where to turn.
True.
You know what I mean? A lot of times, you know, like back in the day, you know, when you had your child, your mom was right there.
Mm-hmm.
That's no longer really happening. You know what I mean? You have so many young women saying, you know, oh, I don't speak to my mom, or I ran away, or mm-hmm. my grandparents are raising me, or my aunt is raising me.
It becomes a female collision, like.
Mm-hmm. But
that happens at the same time when it comes down to young boys and men too. Like, you can't be two kings of the castle sometimes.
Yeah, definitely. Islamically, when I married a woman and her son is of a certain age, he got to go with his father, because we'd be battling for attention with his mother for him as a child and me with my wife. But people like, but I said that to say, the WO has been taking off the women's name, mm-hmm. and y'all don't know how to put it back on. So they run around here doing everything that niggas should be doing, opening up the cars, fixing it, getting their gas, going, doing this, paying all their bills. So when you get a man to open the door, tell you beautiful, or say, let me pump your car and get the gas, let me get that, I don't need that, and they don't know how to put it back on.
Mm-hmm.
And they forced to be that.
Well, listen, right? You ever take notice that usually when being referred into, oh, I'm a strong black woman. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a strong, but no one else puts strong before their race. You don't hear people saying, oh, I'm a strong white woman. I'm a strong Asian woman. I'm a strong,
where they come from?
It's pushed through society. It's everything is engineered to separate, divide and conquer, and also to empower the woman. But if you notice, just by saying black woman, you're saying strong woman. Mm-hmm. By saying black woman, mm-hmm. you're saying powerful woman.
Mm-hmm.
It's more powerful than saying a strong woman.
It's way more powerful.
You're saying the way that they're saying it, it might be denoting that they might be feeling as though black is weak. And that's how you're saying it? Like, they're saying strong black woman as though, like, other women that's black might be considered as weak, but I'm a strong one.
Not necessarily. I'm just saying that it's not even necessary to say a strong black woman, because you're saying the same thing twice.
Yeah.
You feel it's me? More effective.
More strong.
Okay. Understood. And, well, I got online, somebody just mentioned that she thinks that your opinion was one-sided. She said, sometimes when you don't know any better, how can you do better?
She right. said,
my opinion? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Which one? Which one I say?
She said, about your mother women. And father is your role model to become and who to look for. If your parents didn't teach you or show you a good path. So she's pretty much saying the same
which
thing.
Which one?
That I was saying, which is like,
what women don't know how
need,
to think, though.
We need to make sure that we have good examples.
Oh, to empower them?
We got to make sure that, yeah, because what happens is that, like, again, Most of these kids are running around raising themselves.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's hard. And I'm saying that from you know, personal experience. You know, I've taken neighborhood kids from my block, kids from my neighborhood, who most of their fathers have done time, still doing time, got life sentences. Thank God they had the opportunity, because they caught those sentences when they were juveniles. They had the opportunity to come home now.
To come back.
But it's like, I'm big unk now. You know what I'm saying? I'm their uncle, because they didn't have nobody else as adults to be there and to show them anything in regards to manhood. So they were raising themselves. And you got a block full of women that's, you know, pretty much just saying, don't get locked up and don't get killed, but survive.
Yeah, because they got the Willie Lynch syndrome that they got that was from the Willie Lynch letter. Mm-hmm. When you get the buck. That's where the buck come from, the young bucks.
Mm-hmm.
Right. They will go to the islands, Jamaica. This is why the homosexuality mm-hmm. is not socially mm-hmm. accepted in Jamaica. Let me explain. The Willie Lynch letter came from, well, how to break a nigga. He was trying to teach other white plantation work owners how to get control of their niggas. He went over there to the islands. He raped men mm-hmm. in front of other men. Mm-hmm. The strongest man, the strongest young buck that was wilding out.
Mm-hmm.
He'd fuck him right in their ass in front of all with his baby mom and everybody, his kids, mm-hmm. his brothers and sisters, and rape them. Then get a horse to get one leg and the other leg, and then smack the horse and rip them apart.
Mm-hmm.
So now, while your mom is pregnant what will happen? It would breed into the baby fear, and she will always push the daughters out and hold the boys. Mm-hmm. And that's what women do now. They hold their babies. They, oh, that's my son. That's my son, though. No, you got to let your son be a man. You got to, and reverse. Mm-hmm. So the women are going out doing all the jobs because the women was trying to protect their young bucks because she knew what would happen.
That this society will not care for them. This society will try their best to break them. This society will try their best to make sure that they don't survive. And this is a reality. And that goes back to what I was saying. Like, unfortunately, this society is still demasculating us. Like, we have an issue right now where they're speaking on the news and saying that you have toxic masculinity. And it's like, how can you have toxic masculinity when being a man is all that I know? Being a man, being masculine, this comes from my nature. This isn't something which is, you know, it becomes toxic, I guess, when you're trying to say that, well, the feminine side is not for masculinity.
So my thing is there's a balance. Everything was created, you know, in the universal harmony, in the universal balance. Mm-hmm. We have male and masculine energy and female energy for a reason, exactly.
And the woman was created from the rib of the man. Mm-hmm. So when you try to break a woman, in actuality, you're breaking yourself. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Now let's go back.
And a lot of women, what I wanted to say to piggyback off of what Buckwild was saying is that some women are raising their sons only to love them. Mm-hmm. They're not showing that man how to cope when he's angry. They're not showing him how to have a family and be a leader of that family and how to have that same reverence and love and respect that you have for me as your mother to your wife, you know? Mm-hmm. A lot of these men, they're mama's boys. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And women are only going to be as strong as the men.
Right. Right. I mean, it was
in every society. Like, if the men were strong, the women, behind every strong man, there's a strong woman. Mm-hmm. So if it's a strong man, then the woman would be strong. But because men are so weak and we're dealing with, you know, homosexuality and things of that nature, so the women are weak. It's right. Not an excuse, but it's just, you know, being aware.
So who are we going to blame it on?
I was trying to, let's not go the blame route, but rearing and cultivating the youth. Mm-hmm. How do we do this properly? Back to, all the problems. We know there's a lot of problems. Mm-hmm.
Let's be solution-oriented people, right?
Where the child is hurting, mm-hmm. where the youth is hurting. And I believe that the key is understanding the individual, mm-hmm. because it starts with home. Your mother, your father, anyone whom is under that roof is your first teachers. So if they are being attentive and learning you as you learn yourself, then and instilling good morals and integrity in you and allowing you to develop and grow, then everyone can become on the same accord in figuring out, well, what is it that you can succeed in? What is it that you like? Okay, well, let's do business with family. A lot of people and a lot of sayings are, oh, well, don't mix family and business. And you look at a lot of other cultures, mm-hmm. and see how
corporations it's owned by only entire families. Exactly. Look at the Rothschilds.
Mm.
Look at the Bilderbergs.
Mm.
Look at the
Rockefellers.
Remember how we had
the real Rockefellers.
Remember how we had block captains?
Mm-hmm.
Like
still
that
do.
Person
you still
who
do.
Looks out for everybody.
Yeah.
And if you seen somebody's child acting up, you know, it takes a village to raise children. And you know, if you seen Mrs. Jones, mm-hmm. and you was doing something you wasn't supposed to be doing, you was out. Because you knew Mrs. Jones was going to tell your mom, and then you was going to get your behind beat. So I think we're in today's time, we're afraid to chastise someone else's child. You want to know why? Because that parent might come up and say, oh, don't be talking to my child, you know what I mean, this type of way, and may even bring a handgun.
Yep.
Right, and everything is, everybody taking their phones out, and so on and so forth. So I think it's the matter of the education level.
Mm-hmm.
having more counselors in the school, being able to recognize signs of anxiety and depression and being withdrawn and so on and so forth. So we need to have those people there as even as volunteers. You know what I mean? Who, what agencies can we reach out to and ask them, can they volunteer so that we can get a coalition going to go in these schools and take an hour or two and just meet with the fifth graders, you know what I mean, or the third graders on up, you know what I mean, and just take that time and actually just try to assess them. Because what about the children who are dying from suicide? Mm-hmm. And suicide is the 10th leading cause of death. Mm-hmm. So, you know, either these children are being killed by other children, or they're being caught in a crossfire because there's some crap that the adult got going on, or where they don't want to live. Yeah. So we need to get into these schools. We need to come up with some type of strategy on how we're going to save our children. And the first thing that I could think of is maybe reaching out to some psychologists or some social workers and things of that nature, and asking them would they be willing to volunteer some of their time and just start a movement. Because, you know, unfortunately, the adults are, we're jacked up.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? We got issues beyond issues. Mm-hmm. And so now it's time to put our focus on these children, because it's horrible. It's horrible. And, you know, unfortunately, we don't find out what's going on until it's a death.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, we need to try to be a preventative, you know what I mean, and figure out what we're going to do. So any other ideas on what we can do? I say reach out to different organizations and see if we can get them to do some volunteer work, to go into these, literally walk into these schools and say, we need to assess these children from first grade on up, kindergarten on up. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Let's continue this conversation. For all those who tune on to the live, make sure that you continue to send us your thoughts, send us your comments. For those who tune into the YouTube, make sure you send us your comments. For all those who here, make sure you get with us and call in live, 215-881-3664. We're going to continue this conversation. But for now, let's get to the next music on the playlist.
I mean, Nas is one of the greatest. Can we get a chance? Chaz. I mean, the echo of life is the echo of love, and the echo of love is the echo from above, and some people, they don't even really know what they're doing. God damn. I mean, can you feel this? Can you feel the vibe? Can you feel the zone? The zone that we own, the zone that we own. I mean, the zone that we own is the zone of our own.
Yeah. How much money you got? How much money you got? How much money you got?
Yeah, though, welcome back to NR International. This is Philly's Finest. You now rocking with the best, Mr. Make It Rain, Lord Rainey, and
Flawless Flaw. Peace, love.
We have our special guest in the building, comedian Buck Wild, 215. Make sure you follow him. And as well, we have Gift of the Pen, my favorite poet. So, let's get to this DK news.
DK?
We just listened to that 21 Savage, right? Mm-hmm. Right after listening to that Echo by Nas. Mm-hmm. But this week in news, what we got in this week in news?
DK, 21 Savage has been deported. Ironically, after doing some controversial / inspirational / eye-opening performances and bringing light to Flint, Michigan. But when he got into several altercations, police altercations, with an expired visa due to like drugs, but you know, promoting ignorance and drug use and violence, they didn't deport him then. Mm-hmm. Ironically. Yeah, 21 Savage, man. Guess he'll be a pen pal for now.
Free him.
Yeah.
Free him.
That's fucked up.
DK!
So you said when he's promoting ignorance. it was cool.
Yeah, like
but when he starts saying black power, he's not putting jury on no more. Yes. Uplifting his neighborhood from Atlanta.
They deported him. They straight shipped back to the UK.
Yeah, what he said was that his visa been expired since 2006.
Is that in our international
peace? Hey, love. How y'all doing tonight?
Everything is good. What's going on, family?
Hello?
Peace, love.
This is international. Who am I speaking to? Yes, yes. Can you hear me?
Hi.
You on a live? Talk to me.
Nope. I hung up. Try again. The lines are open.
Yeah, you gotta make sure they stay off the radio, too.
Okay.
Like, causes.
All right, so...
What you mean the radio? What that mean?
Well, at the
like
same
our radio
time, so
live.
Then,
yeah. At the same time, and then try to call in and still listen to the radio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But back to what we were saying about 21. 21. He's been his visa was expired since 2006, and ever since that time period, now he's, you know, pretty much, now underneath the gun, about you know getting deported. After. I mean, he's trying to make a conscious change, or not even a conscious change, but just having some songs is not dumbed down, like we were just talking about. Like, it's going against the system, I guess. So, this is when they decide to get him out of here. Right?
Absolutely.
What we got next on DK?
DK. Tuesday Countdown begins. Are y'all ready? Mayhem.
What you know about mayhem?
Somebody get shot,
somebody gotta die. Yes, Saturday. Make sure y'all tune in to. It's going on Vimeo and on YouTube. I will be on Mayhem season finale playing Madoff. You know, everybody was saying for a long time that I look like Madoff, and I guess they got a chance to. They called and said,
yeah.
So they called and said, "Come on." So make sure y'all check that out. Mayhem. What else we got?
DK,
did you know?
Flawless Flaw Fully Finesse drops February 14th. Yes, I love you guys. And because I love you guys so much, February 15th, Flawless will be doing drop-offs of her EP apparel. Just text or call 267-223-5918. Tickets are available. It is going down the 23rd. At Mill Creek's Tavern. Yes, Shelliano will be hosting, and it is going to be a corporation takeover, baby. You already know how we do.
Absolutely. And also, make sure y'all check out in Atlanta, in Detroit, and a couple other cities that still have not got a chance to see the Miss Black America pageant. I was the photographer and videographer for the Miss Black America pageant. It's aired live already on... It's already aired in LA, it's already aired in New York, and it's already aired in Philadelphia. So make sure for those cities who have not seen it yet, stay tuned. Make sure y'all check y'all listings to see what time it will air in your city.
He's out there on some pervert stuff. Miss America. This nigga ain't tell me nothing about Miss America. See, even 30 times.
When I saw that on the rim, I was like, okay.
Of course, but
always
get the invite.
Oh,
get the invite. All right, so. Yeah, let me know what y'all got going on. Let's talk.
What you got going on, Queen?
Yes.
All married and happy. Glowing.
That's a good thing.
I wish I was married.
So basically, when I was thinking about things to discuss, I was thinking about balance. It's something about balance. Mm-hmm. Because when you're multi-talented, you kind of feel torn most of the time. So, you know, it's been 10 years and I think I have a lot of growing to do as far as a author and a poet. However, I can go into different cities and people be like, oh, you gifted a pen. You know what I mean? Whereas, you know, I am gifted, which is the seamstress. No one knows. I don't think anyone really knows that I sew. And, you know, most people know that I teach classes, but people don't really know that I sew because I'm not, I haven't been as proficient as far as, like, posting everything that I make.
So you do poetry and you teach, what kind of class you teach?
Sewing classes.
And she's, and she's a published author.
Mm-hmm. Right. So this weekend I'm having a photo shoot.
Nice.
And some guy I know with a big key and glasses is going to be taking a photo.
Is it ready?
In the
international. Shout out to international.
So,
international. Welcome to international. Well,
turn your radio off.
I only got my Apple. I can't really hear y'all, but I'm this drum song that we're doing. So I'm really at work. I'm going to try to make a quick for y'all.
Okay.
I want to say brief on the last subject that y'all were talking about with this. Kind of like the sister and psyche of us as a people. And I would like to address kind of like the social media aspect of it, how, you know, y'all trying to, we need to respect our women more and respect ourselves more.
Absolutely.
I feel like it's like a double-edged sword dealing with the Instagram and stuff like that, because a lot of women out there are just showing their stories and ill manners and photos and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And of course, guys are just gonna like them and they doing it for attention. Now, on one hand, the girls might not necessarily act like the way they're being portrayed, but they go off and doing it for attention. But we gotta stop liking photos in order for them to stop putting that stuff out there on that sort of vicious cycle. You know what I'm saying? So,
no doubt.
We not respect women more because they just want themselves to like a show off as a ticket to get on to the next person who's living
on a certain level that they want to be on, or whatever they're seeking out of it. It's kind of like ill manners. Like, it's the difference between modeling and just showing up these type of promiscuous photos and getting comments and guys coming at them. You know what I mean? It's a vicious cycle of the mind that is playing on both ends. That don't, it's doing, there's no real good out of it. You know what I'm saying? And I can't really hear y'all responding, so I ain't really trying to talk over y'all.
I definitely agree, you know, especially as
Ross, can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you.
Ross.
I'm gonna try to answer this question, but as far as the 21 situation, I kind of, I don't know the whole details, but I know that they were saying that he tried to, a lot of paperwork and stuff, but at what point, though, because I just feel like once he started touching real money and you know he was illegal, you kind of had to, the team and the parents and yourself, you kind of should have been on that. But I just don't know. I can't say too much because I don't know how far along he tried to, how early on he tried to renew his paperwork and everything like that. But I do agree with y'all that it's a messed up situation where when he switched up his family and tried to be positive, now they're going to take him out from this.
Yeah.
They did this because somebody told you to go on the positive list and they did it to flip back in the day. You know what I'm saying? But, I'm gonna let y'all go because I can't really hear it, but I'm gonna see if y'all, you know, with y'all comment, I'll try to call back in or whatever.
Definitely appreciate you, big homie. Thank you for calling in.
Thank you. Peace, love.
Yeah,
so, you say he was on the earpiece?
Yeah. Well, pretty much he said everything that we were saying, that there's certain things that's for private and there's certain things for the public. The things for the public, we got to make sure that, you know, we be respectful. Yeah, we got
to
make sure we respectful with it.
Why are you allowed to twerk? Like,
yeah, that's something to be done in the bedroom, in the living room, when you with your girls. You know what I'm saying? Something to be done.
And these people are like certified, like it says certified model, like. Because you be twerking?
Yeah.
I'm just trying to figure out who's certified.
See, that's
no,
weird.
Certified model means you get a public page. Instagram. You can make money off your page.
Exactly.
Oh, my thing is like.
They making money off their page.
Exactly.
Everybody twerking, get a check.
Yup.
See, what happens is that it's like, that's where the blurred line.
Oh, so when you get certified, Instagram makes money off of your page.
No.
Really?
You make money.
Yeah.
Okay. Off of twerk videos. So they ain't doing it for free.
See, a lot of people
don't know who's going
to for free. Somebody have a certified page. Or public figure page, they can get a check. They can receive residual income.
Mm-hmm.
Because what you don't know is that those big companies pay Facebook to advertise things on their page. Facebook can say, look, we're going to give you $175 to put an ad up there. You got 40 ads up there. So you might be making damn near $5,000 a month just off
the ad. Shit, I need some money like that.
That's why you got to teach people. That's why I got an empowerment class where I teach young entrepreneurs, comedians, or whoever come, how to hustle on your marketing. If I got 32,000 followers And if I can't get 10,000 of them niggas to give me some money, right, then I'm in the way.
Right.
I don't care if a girl got 100,000 followers. Mm-hmm. If you got 100,000 followers, then all of them should give you $5 a piece.
Right.
Right.
You got to make some. You got to make your followers shareholders of your company.
Mm-hmm.
Like when I be like Black Hollywood, you hear me, Black Hollywood. I'm not waiting. I'm working. When I hashtag that, I'm getting a check. Anything on my page you see me advertise by anybody, I'm getting a check.
Absolutely.
And once I put it up and we done, I'm taking it down and I'm marketing me. Mm-hmm. Ain't no, you got to hustle yourself. Mm-hmm. So you got to put strings up and you can pay right now. You give them your credit card. Go get a secure credit card from Walmart. Put $200 on there. Mm-hmm. Put it on your Facebook because it's connected to your Instagram. And you push your brand out without cursing and market yourself so people can come to your profile page. And they go to your profile page and then they be like, damn, I didn't know she's so. Now they buying your product.
Y'all getting game right here.
Mm-hmm. Free. I charge for this shit.
Right.
But that's what you do.
Okay. You well, also, what you got coming up?
I got Atlantic City March 22nd or 22nd or 27th. We got Nas coming to AC.
Okay.
They got like 15 artists coming with them. It's called We Lit. I'm hosting that. I got a show in Atlantic City at the House of Blues.
Mm-hmm.
Me, Brother Man from Martin Lawrence.
Brother Man, Fifth Flow.
Cole from Martin Lawrence. And Toya Hart, Kevin Hart, ex-wife. We doing a comedy show. My man, Big Business, called Millionaire. It's called Millionaire Weekend, where he empowered the people that's doing housing, credit. He's teaching. He's doing the whole seminar every week. He got ET, Wallow 267, Greg Parker, a Big Business. He got a movie, and then they're giving away a house, a duplex, to whoever get the. Everybody that purchases tickets automatic enters a raffle, and the winner going to win a duplex.
That's beautiful.
In Brewery Town, so every house in Brewery Town is going to be worth at least $300,000. Mm-hmm. So he's giving you a duplex, and you start your own business.
That's nice.
Oh, and I also before you got off. I also have a nonprofit called Comics Care, and what we do, we empower the youth through education and apprenticeship. And I got teamed up with Greg Parker, teamed up with Mel Wells for One Day at a Time, my partner Hassan, and Local 56. That's teaching other kids how to get their records expunged and how to get everybody that graduate from a juvenile facility, we taking them on a prom. So we trying to take three to 200 kids on a prom, because when you graduate, get a GED, you're going on your prom.
Right.
So we doing that. We're going to get with Saudi.
Wow,
and
good.
We got a lot of big stuff going on. And we clean up the neighborhood. It's called the Adopt the Block Program. And One Day at a Time, guy. Back to the block. Back to the block.
This last episode.
Yeah, yeah. So the Adopt the Block Program. And one block at a time. With One Day at a Time, we coming together. We clean up the neighborhoods. We getting the kids to knock on the doors. Find out who need food. Knock on the doors. Who need medicine. Get them little bikes that you keep seeing in every little neighborhood that's not being utilized. We paying them with Comics Care One Day at a Time or Local 57 credit card, or we're going to help Greg Parker and get the kids on the bike. They go to Walmart, go to CVS, get them medicine, bring it back to the old people, paint the block.
Mm-hmm.
Remember we used to paint the block? Mm-hmm. Clean up them lots. Put the cop joint up there to police your own neighborhoods. We don't need the police to police us. They ain't doing shit anyway. Half of them.
Right.
But the even if you got good cops, they always say, there's a lot of good cops out here. Well, what about when the bad cops doing shit, why the good cops ain't stepping up?
Right.
That's what make you good.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? Not shitting on all the cops out there, but do something. Be a voice. Go back. I used to love when I was small, I always, police officer, nothing. They got one to be the bad guy now. And that's fucked up because you got a lot of kids that think like that.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? So we got to give back. And I just came from Chester Jail, where I was incarcerated, and it was called the Comedy Behind the Wall. We trying to get Netflix to pick it up. Or Kevin Hart to put it on his, shout out to my man Rob Ruler from Chester, all the lifers in Chester, that welcomed us with open arms. And we came back and I was like, it's called Laughter Behind the Wall. We went in the jail, I took Ski Car to Malcolm Hill, Stiletto, Denny Live, and we went in there, we gave back to the same streets we helped destroy. Or at least me, by selling drugs, acting like I was a cop, selling coke, shooting at niggas. I did a lot of shit before I became Buck Wild. So I tell niggas all the time, like, I want to be like you. You want to be like me, but you don't want to go through what I went through to become Buck Wild. So I'm living proof that you can go to jail and do 7.5 years in jail and come home and get your record expunged. and go into a jail and get back by talking.
You're not so, even talking about the youth awareness program.
Oh yeah, the youth awareness program is crazy. So man, is we he live. This is my man. He ain't never changed.
Yeah.
So we live in proof, man, that you can go to jail and come home and make it, man. So I'm a product of my environment.
On that note, we're gonna close out with a poem by.
A change won't come. It starts within me. See, I got demons haunting me. On the contrary, it may be hereditary. This pretty face and chinky eyes are not enough to get by. I am limitless alone, welcoming my maturity. Gangs out like the 90s, right with Atari, becoming a woman I'm destined to be. No testosterone or labels validating me. I was a slave, but a slime came to set me free. Stevie Wonder to the drama. Hard hurting, but I'm lesson learning. Dividing truth from fiction. This is pivotal. Take a seat in class. If you're not learning, you're stagnating. If you're not growing, you're stagnating. If you're not learning, you're procrastinating. And if you're not real, man, you pump faking. Depression be chasing me because happiness is my champion. Because I know the hawk. Ain't no need in complaining. The images shown on these TV screens and lyrics being played are enough to drive us insane. Keeping up with the have and the have nots, making the rich filthy is meanwhile they're closing down our libraries and building more prisons. Excuse me, my mind it runs deep. I'm watching this generation, I'm afraid for these babies because women are men and men are women. Righteousness is a new sin and sin is the new righteousness. I just want us all to win. I'm reminded of 2 days, the day that I died in judgment. I'm not perfect, y'all, but I'm a darn sure strive for it. So you do you and I'ma do me, and just remember there's no I in team. I just want to die in a state of belief.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm giving that. Hey, me do the most.
Y'all like that.
So, if y'all interested in following me at Gift of the Pen. Oh, I got a gift for y'all, the ladies.
Yes. The ladies.
The ladies. Yes. I have a women's hoodie.
We like to thank Gifts of the Pen for coming out here and not bringing no gifts for me. Thank you so much for coming out here.
Well, I
said, Mom,
my gift
is. Me, I'm the gift. I'm cash.
I'm cash.
That's all we got. Don't cash.
I got cash.
So, y'all can follow me on Gifts of the Pen. And yeah, so. And I am gifted. So if you go to Gifted.
Very. And let them know you make clothes.
Very, very gifted.
You teach classes.
Yeah,
you teach Talene.
Who say I teach Talene?
You put in their own feet. We got those. We got pussy, baby.
On that note, I'm going to just end this with the quote of the day. It's an old Yoruban proverb. And that is, it takes a village to raise a child. You heard all the problems early in the show. And you just heard some of the solutions. Some of the ways in which we're giving back. You heard some of the ways in which people, individuals, are getting together to make something for the kids to grow up, knowing that they've done something and they continue to pass that legacy down the line. This is NR International. Make sure you tune in every Thursday, 5:30 p.m. to 7, or streetstv.com, or you can get the app. It's been beautiful, it's been real. Catch y'all next week. So, my man, it's been great. Black Hollywood.
You lie to me between your teeth, homie. Say you ride for me, but then you sleep. No, 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 no. I cannot sleep on beef, no, no, no. Cause it won't get to me. Can't move slow. I needed a hand, it's that right over me. Rigos a little boy, I'ma just go OT. I made it work bouncing on trampoline. You cannot cat with me, you are not catching me. No, 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 no. I grab on the door, I sit my dreams on it. Step on the red carpet.